Hello friends, I'm Anvesha and I welcome all of you to my channel Aspiring Banker Anvesha. Today in this video, I'll be discussing mock test questions for your SBI clerk mains examination. If you're new to the channel, please subscribe to the channel and also click the bell icon to get notified for the upcoming sessions. So before your clerk mains examination, I will be uploading videos discussing questions every day in the morning, okay?
This is the first RC in front of you. So at first I'll read the RC and explain the meaning. After that I'll go to the questions, okay? The bail-in clause of the Financial Resolution and Deposit Insurance Bill has led to worries about the safety of bank deposits. Apparently the bill enables the government to confiscate. Confiscate means seize. The deposits of ordinary citizens in order to save troubled public sector banks. Okay. So, the first line talks about something called bail-in clause. Okay. And this bail-in clause is a danger led to worries about the safety of bank deposits. A danger for bank deposits. Bank deposits means common man, I and you, common man. Deposits money in banks, okay, right? And this bail-in clause is a danger for these deposits, okay? Why? Because this enables the government to seize your deposit, okay, to confiscate, to seize your deposit, to take your deposits. In order to save troubled public sector banks. So if banks face loss, then the government can seize your deposit. Yet amidst all the economic punditry over the safety of bank deposits under the FRDI, a large threat to the deposits of ordinary citizens has slipped under the radar. It is the push by governments towards a cashless economy. Now, from this first paragraph, you can answer the first question, okay? So, let's go to the first question. After that, I will explain the meaning of this part. Yet, amidst all the economic punditry over the safety, okay, let me tell you the meaning of this word punditry. Punditry means expertise. Okay, expertise. Over the safety of bank deposits, a large threat to the deposits of ordinary people has slipped under the radar. Okay. Now, please answer the first question. What is meant by the idiom slipped under the radar? Okay. What is meant by the idiom slipped under the radar? An aircraft flying low to avoid being detected by radar. Now, the paragraph does not talk about any aircraft. So, this is wrong. Okay. To go unnoticed, to come under spotlight, an unlucky happening to be forgotten. Okay, now let's understand. Yet amidst all the economic punditry over the safety of bank deposits under the FRDI. The economic experts, what are they saying? They are saying that bank deposits are safe under the FRDI. Okay, but a large threat to the deposits of ordinary citizens, threat to the deposits, danger to the deposits because of bail-in clause has slipped under the radar. What is the meaning of this? It has gone unnoticed. No one is noticing it. So what is the meaning of slipped under the radar? The meaning is to go unnoticed. To come under the spotlight is exactly the opposite. Exactly the opposite. So this is not your answer. An unlucky happening, the passage does not discuss about any unfortunate event, no. To be forgotten. Now, what is the difference between these two? To be forgotten and to go unnoticed. Okay. To be forgotten means what? You notice something. Notice or observe or make a note of something. And then you forget it. Yes, this is the meaning of to be forgotten. But what is the meaning of to go unnoticed? To not take into account to not notice at all. And this is what is happening. The danger of the deposits, the threat to the deposits are not being noticed at all. So this is your answer. Okay. Now, let's read the next paragraph. Okay. To understand why it needs to be reiterated that by far the biggest challenge for a government launching a bail-in attack on deposits is that depositors can promptly withdraw their money from the bank by demanding cash. Okay. Such an event can lead to severe bank runs and destabilize the banking system because bank deposits are only fractionally backed by actual cash. The biggest challenge for a government launching a, what is a challenge? There is a challenge for the government that is launching a bail-in attack on deposits. And the challenge is that the depositors can withdraw their money from the bank by demanding cash. Okay, the meaning is, suppose you have an account in ICICI Bank and you know that ICICI Bank is not doing well. Suppose you have an account in PNB. Now this is more relevant. You have an account in PNB. You know that PNB is not performing well and you have 1 lakh rupees deposited in PNB. Okay, your balance, account balance is 1 lakh rupees in PNB. Okay, so what do you do when you come to know that the bank is not performing well? You go to the bank, deposit a check or something, or you withdraw this 1 lakh rupees. Okay, and this is the threat of the bail-in. This is the threat, this is the problem of bail-in, that the government is not able to confiscate the deposit. Okay, this is the problem, because you are withdrawing the money. Such an event can lead to severe bank runs. Now the bank is already not performing well. Okay, and then all the depositors are withdrawing their money. So what will happen? The bank will go into a severe cash crunch. Okay, so this will destabilize the banking system because deposits, now the bank does not have the money. Okay, you have deposited, but the bank uses that money for other activities. Now your cash is actually not, your money is actually not backed by actual cash. Okay, so this is a problem for the bank when you go and ask your money back. In fact, under pure gold standard, it was the threat of bank runs that forced commercial banks to keep their deposits fully backed at any time with sufficient gold in the vault. Now, because of this problem, the commercial banks actually guarantee your money, okay, guarantee your money by keeping sufficient gold in their vault, okay. So suppose for example 100 crores is the total deposit that a particular bank has, PNB has. So what will PNB do? Now PNB does not have the actual cash of 100 crores with it. Okay, so PNB will keep gold of this amount with itself so that whenever you come and ask your money back, it can give you the money back. Okay, next. Such rapid withdrawal of cash deposits, however, may slowly cease to be an option for depositors as world increasingly turns away from cash towards digital money. Okay, so this kind of rapid withdrawal, the bank is not performing well, you go to the bank and rapidly you withdraw your money. Now this is not going to be an option anymore. Okay, it will slowly stop being an option. Stop, cease means stop. Stop to be an option for depositors because the world is increasingly turning from cash towards digital money. Okay, when all or even a predominant share of money in the world is digital, there is no question of banks having to meet depositors' demand for cash. Now, if the whole world is going to become digital, if all the money is going to become digital now, then the bank won't have to give you the cash, okay, if you want it. So cashless world will once and for all free banks from the obligation to meet cash demands from depositors. Now if the world becomes cashless, the banks will not have this obligation by the banks will not be bound to give you the cash whenever you demand. Okay, thus protecting them from liquidity crisis, and this will protect the banks, them means the banks, from liquidity crisis. More importantly, it would also strip depositors of the power, of the power to withdraw their deposits in the form of cash. Now this will, you know, now the depositors won't be able to withdraw their deposits in the form of cash to escape any tax or any forms of confiscation by the government. Okay, fine. So this is the meaning of the paragraph. Now we will go to the questions. Now this is the second question. Which of the following would be a suitable title for the cashless revolution, bail-in and its hidden risks, welfare government versus private sector, perils of going cashless, the new age banking system? Okay, what is a suitable title? So one is summary, one is central idea or the theme, and then comes your title. What is the difference between these three? Summary covers all the points. Summary is something that covers all the points of the paragraph but in a concise way. Central idea or theme is the main point, the main idea. That is the idea around which the entire passage revolves. The idea that has been discussed in all the paragraphs and the three paragraphs. What is title? Title is a concise form of the central idea. Concise form of central idea. If your central idea is of 30 words, your title will be of mere 5 to 6 words. Okay? Now understand, let's understand this title for this passage. Cashless revolution. Cashless revolution. Okay. Now, let's go to the passage. The first one. First one talks about bail-in clause. Bail-in clause. Right? Okay. Now, also it talks about the danger to deposits. Yep. Second one also talks about the deposits. The third one talks about the deposits and the danger that you cannot withdraw your deposit. This one also talks about the thing that people are withdrawing the deposits and this is destabilizing the banking systems. Okay, fine. So let's see. Cashless revolution, no. Bail-in and its hidden risks, can be, yes. Welfare government versus private government, nowhere mentioned, sorry. Perils of going cashless, can be. The new age banking system, no. Okay. Now, the answer can be either B or D. Okay. So, bail-in and its hidden risks. Bail-in and its hidden risks. Okay. Now, bail-in and its hidden risk has been discussed only in the first paragraph. Okay. But the entire all these passages actually talks about your cashless system and the danger of the cashless system. So let's see. If you look at this paragraph, to understand why it needs to be reiterated, destabilize the banking system because bank deposits, okay, it was the threat of bank runs that forced commercial banks to keep, okay, fine. So actually, the thing is, The bail-in clause will effectively come in picture when the economy turns cashless. Before that, it cannot. Why? Because people are withdrawing their money. So it cannot come. So it will come into picture when economy becomes cashless. And when economy becomes cashless, it will strip depositors of the power to withdraw their deposits in the form of cash. Okay, so danger to deposit. It is a danger to deposit. So what is the correct answer? The correct answer is perils of going cashless. This should be your title because the entire passage revolves around this. Perils means danger. Danger. Okay, let's go to the next question now. Given that the first sentence of the next paragraph to the passage is, when it comes to the war on cash, there is a lot more to it than what just meets the eye. Which of the following could be some possible reasons for the government preferring a cashless economy? Okay. The question says that if we have one more paragraph after this, and if the first sentence of the next paragraph is this, when it comes to the war on cash, there is a lot more to it than what just meets the eye. Which of the following could be some possible reasons for the government preferring a cashless economy? Okay. Why the government would prefer a cashless economy? Why? Now the answer to this question is not given in the paragraph. Could be some possible reasons. Now this is a very ambiguous question. Okay, the answer is not given in the paragraph. It is open for interpretation. So in your exam, if you find these kind of questions, this pattern, then please skip. This is a question that should be skipped. But here I will explain you. But in your examination, it is better to skip. Okay, so why the government is preferring a cashless economy? To escape negative interest rates, depositors who would essentially be locked in by banks will have no other option but to spend their money kept in their accounts. A cashless world makes it easier for banks to carry out the business of credit creation. It would be easier to detect tax evasion. Okay, easier to detect tax evasion. This one is given. Fair? In the last. Here. To escape any tax. So depositors will not be able to withdraw their money in the form of cash to escape any tax. Okay. So this answer, this one we are getting from the paragraph itself. The others. Let's see. A cashless world makes it easier for banks to carry out business of credit creation. Yes. Now what will happen if the world is cashless? Then banks can easily carry out their business of credit creation. Okay, why? Because then the money will be digital. Banks do not need to keep the cash. The money will be digital and it will be very easy to create credit. So this is also true. First one, to escape negative interest rates, depositors who would essentially be locked in by banks will have no other option. Okay. Now the thing is, suppose the bank is not performing well. Okay, the bank is not performing well, right? The depositor has 1 lakh rupees in the bank. Okay, fine. The depositor has 1 lakh rupees in the bank. The bank is not performing well. The depositor cannot withdraw. Cannot withdraw. What will he do if he cannot withdraw? And the bank is also not performing well, he will either spend the money or he will invest the money. Yes, in both ways it is profitable for the bank. Why? Because the depositor is not closing its account. This is one thing. The depositor is not closing its account. The second thing is the depositor is making transactions through the bank itself. Okay, not by withdrawing the money but by spending the money somewhere. Okay, that also the bank is paying. So in a way it is helping the bank, or investing by investing the money. So 1, 2, and 3, all of the above. This question is ambiguous, is an ambiguous question. Please skip it if you find these kind of question in the exam. Next, as per the passage, what are the weaknesses of the government's bail-in plan? Weakness, what are the challenges? What are the weaknesses of the government's bail-in plan? Bank deposits are backed by actual cash? No, it is not backed by actual cash. Partially by gold. It is actually backed by gold in their vault. Okay. Depositors can promptly withdraw their money from the bank by demanding cash. Yes, an event where depositors demand cash before a bail-in can lead to severe bank runs and destabilize the banking system. This is given in the passage itself. See, look at this part. Such an event can lead to severe bank runs and destabilize the banking system. Okay, and then here you have the biggest challenge for a government launching a bail-in attack on deposits is that depositors can promptly withdraw the money from the bank. Okay, here is your answer. So the right answer is your 2 and 3. D. Okay, fine. Okay, now this is the next RC. So let's do it the same way. I'll read the RC and explain to you. Solar power played almost no part in Vietnam's energy mix in 2017. To speed the technology's adoption, the government offered that year to pay suppliers a generous $0.09 for every kilowatt hour produced by big solar farms, but only if they started operations within the following 2 years. It expected some 850 megawatt of capacity to be installed. Instead, by the end of 2019, the country found itself with 5 gigawatts, more than Australia, with an economy almost 6 times the size. Now, this is the first question. What is the primary purpose of the author in the first paragraph? To highlight the unexpected surge in solar power production in Vietnam, to highlight how subsidies can help in accelerating the growth of solar power, to highlight the rise in popularity of solar power, to highlight the energy needs of a developing country, none of the above. Okay, let's see. Solar power played almost no part in Vietnam's energy mix in 2017. So in 2017, in Vietnam, solar power was not prevalent. Okay. To speed up the technology's adoption, that is, to bring solar power into picture, the government that year said that suppliers who will be generating solar power, they will be given $0.09 for every kilowatt hour produced by big solar farms. Okay, but only if they started operations within the following 2 years. So a time frame had also been given. So if in the following 2 years it is done, then they will get $0.09 for every kilowatt hour produced. Okay. It expected, it means the government expected 850 megawatt of capacity to be installed. The government thought that okay, 850 megawatt will be installed. Instead, what happened in 2019? The government saw that 5 gigawatts have been installed. 5 gigawatts is more than megawatt, okay? So 5 gigawatt means huge, much more than what had been expected, okay? And it was more than Australia, and Australia had an economy almost 6 times the size of Vietnam, right? Okay, fine. Now, this is your question. What is the primary purpose of the author in the first paragraph of the passage? To highlight the unexpected surge. Surge means increase. To highlight the unexpected increase in solar power production in Vietnam. To highlight how subsidies can help in accelerating the growth of solar power. No. If you look at the question, 1 second please. Yes. If you look at the question, you will be able to understand here. If you look at the passage, it expected 850 megawatt. Instead, by the end of 2019, the country found itself with 5 gigawatt. So this was unexpected. Expected was 850 megawatt. But what happened? 5 gigawatt. Okay, so this was unexpected. And this is, what is the primary purpose of the first paragraph? Okay, The primary purpose of the first paragraph is to highlight the unexpected growth of solar power. Okay. So, the primary purpose of the author in the first paragraph is to highlight the unexpected surge in solar power production. That is the first one. Okay. The next question is, which of the following statements can be inferred from the given passage? Okay. For this, you have to go through the entire passage. Okay. The surge is all the more surprising given the terms on offer from Vietnam Electricity, the cash-strapped state-owned enterprise that runs the national grid. The EVN went for a feed-in tariff approach, which meant that a payment will be made to households or businesses generating their own electricity through the use of methods that do not contribute to the depletion of natural resources proportional to the amount of power generated. Although the government's feed-in tariff was tempting means enticing, attractive. Given that costs typically amount to $0.05 to $0.07 a kilowatt hour, EVN only promise to pay for the power it needed on any given day. What is the meaning of this? The meaning is this increase was surprising, not expected. This increase was not expected. Okay. Why? Because the EVN went for a feed-in tariff approach. What is a feed-in tariff approach? EVN will pay to households or businesses that generate their own electricity using renewable resources. Resources that do not contribute to the depletion of the natural resources, which means renewable resources. Okay, but it will pay only for that quantity, that amount of electricity that it needs. Not if you generate more than that, it will not pay. Okay, if you are not getting paid for the surplus energy that you generate, will you be interested to generate that energy? No, you will not. But still, Vietnam generated so much electricity. Understood? EVN only promised to pay for the power it needed on any given day. They were concerned that the potential investors would buck at this. What is the meaning of buck? Buck means resist. That they will resist at this approach and they will not generate electricity. Okay. That the developers thought about the potential investors. As it turned out, they leapt. Leapt means jumped. They leapt, V2 form of leap. Okay, at the chance to cash in on Vietnam's hunger for power. But it turned out to be exactly the opposite. The potential investors wanted to take advantage, cash in, take advantage of the Vietnam's hunger for power. Power means electricity. Okay. Electricity. So Vietnam was power hungry for electricity. The Vietnam's economy has been growing by 5 to 7% a year for the past two decades. The government has plans to double power generation by 2030, but estimates that supply may run short as soon as next year. It needs to find new sources of power as soon as possible. Okay, so Vietnam's economy has been growing by this percentage every year in the past two decades. The government wants to double its power generation by 2030. But from the recent estimates, it can be seen that Vietnam will not have enough power by next year. Okay, Vietnam needs to find new sources of power as soon as possible. Coal is the base, it is the pillar, cornerstone means pillar or base, foundation of Vietnam's energy supply. But is coal renewable? No, it is not. Under current plans, a fleet of coal-fired power plants will soon triple. The number is going to be thrice. But construction has been dogged by regular delays. Dogged means slowed down. Slowed. By regular delay. Construction of the power plants has been slowed by regular delays, local opposition and flagging investor interest. Okay. Building a new plant takes the better part of a decade. So if Looking at these points, that it has been slowed by regulatory delays, local opposition and flagging investor interest, we can understand that building a power plant will require a decade now. Solar farms in contrast, but solar farms encourage far less opposition. Local people are not opposing solar farms, and solar power farms take about 2 years to build. So coal power plants will take decades to be built, but solar can be built in 2 years. Understood? Right? Okay. Almost all the new facilities are in the sunny south. Okay. The solar boom has not been without problems, but there are problems in the solar power plants as well. What is the problem? The problem is that all the new facilities are in the southeast, where they overwhelm the local grid. Now, because all the facilities are in the southeast, so local grid is being overloaded. And occasionally, because of this, the EVN is refusing to buy power they generate. Okay, EVN is refusing to buy because now local grid has been overburdened. The exact scenario developers had feared exactly this scenario. Moreover, the feed-in tariff is expensive. Now, the feed-in tariff that the government had offered is now expensive for the government. However, the government is adapting. Now, what the government will do? The government has begun improving the grid. Now, there was problem in the local grid, so the government is going to improve the grid. And decreed that in future, decreed means a pronounced, ordered, that in future it would not offer a feed-in tariff. But it instead, what will it do? Auction the right to sell power to the grid, with the winner being the farm that offers to do at the lowest price. So now the generators can auction the solar power. Next, environmentalists hope that solar success will dash the government to scale back its ambitions for coal-fired plants. Okay, so environmentalists believe that the success of the solar power plants will encourage the government to stop the coal-fired plants. Okay, later this year, it is due to release new targets for generation capacity in 2030. Wind and solar have almost already met their current goal. Fine. Now let's go to the questions. Which of the following can be inferred from the information? The only way forward for the government of Vietnam to ensure that the country does not face any power shortage in the coming year is to increase investments in the solar power. Okay, inference. Whenever you have to find out inference, you cannot use extreme words. Extreme words cannot be used. Extreme words like all. This is the only one. Must. These words should not be used, because inferences are never 100% true. You are not 100% confident if whether this is true or not. You are just inferring. Inference is something that is implied in the passage. You understand it from the passage, but you are not 100% confident about it. So you cannot say this is the only way. This is wrong. Okay. Next. The surge in solar power capacity in Vietnam could have been more if the subsidies offered by the EVN were more lucrative. No. This is not the case. The surge in the solar, because already, 850 megawatt was expected and 5 gigawatt was being produced. Okay. So already there was a surge. So the surge could never have been more. Okay. There was a lot, unexpected surge. The rise in solar capacity in Vietnam will ensure that the country will not have to build new thermal power plants for meeting. Will not have to. Now, you cannot be sure about that. It is expected. Look at this paragraph. Environmentalists hope. It is expected. We cannot be sure about it. The thermal power plants won't be needed. We cannot be sure about it. Okay. Developers' assumption that the government's approach to buy electricity as per its requirement would make investors hesitant turned out to be wrong. This is correct. How? From here, look at this part. Developers worried that the potential investors would balk at that, that is resist at that. As it turned out, they leapt at the chance to cash out Vietnam's hunger. So it was exactly the opposite. Developers thought that investors will not be ready because of the government's this feed-in tariff plan, but exactly the opposite happened. Okay, so then it turned out to be wrong. This is the right inference. Okay, also one more thing, inference is implicit. If something is explicitly mentioned in the passage, it will not be your inference. Now this thing has not been explicitly mentioned, it has not been mentioned word for word in the passage. It is something that we understand by reading. That's why this is our answer. Next, which of the following factors have contributed to the solar boom in Vietnam? Why was there solar boom in Vietnam? Lack of global players. So there were very few global players not mentioned in the passage. Institutional obstacles in the construction of coal-fired plants, yes. Shorter time frame for construction of solar plants, yes. So what are the factors that contributed in the success? Solar boom means success. In solar power in Vietnam, what are the factors? So let's see. Here, let's come to this part. Here, coal power plants will soon triple, but construction has dogged by regulatory delays. Construction has been slowed. Construction of coal power plant has been slowed because of regulatory delays, local opposition, flagging investor interest. Now building a new plant will take a decade, but solar power in contrast has no opposition and takes 2 years to build. Now this is the reason that solar boom has been noticed. Okay, the next is the time frame. Yes, look at this part. The first paragraph. The government offered, okay, but only if they started operations within the following 2 years. So there was a strict time frame. Okay, these two factors led to the boom. Shorter time frame, that is 2 years, and obstacles, 2 and 3. Option B. As per the passage, what action has the government taken to tackle the difficulties plaguing the solar power sector? What action has the government taken to tackle the difficulties plaguing the solar power sector? It has decided to increase the feed-in tariff. No, it never decided to increase the feed-in tariff. Rather, it decided to cease the feed-in tariff. It has taken steps to improve the grid, yes. It has announced that the current feed-in tariff policy will be overhauled, that is, it will be changed and it will get replaced by auction-based approach, yes, 2 and 3. Here, the answer is here. Look at this part. It has begun to improving the grid and decreed that in future, no solar feed-in tariff will be offered, but auction the right to sell solar power to the grid. Okay. So 2 and 3 is your answer. Next, refer to the statement, environmentalists hope that solar success will dash the government to scale back its ambitions for coal-fired plants. Which of the following words can fill the blank in the above sentence? Okay, environmentalists hope that solar success will dash the government. The success of solar power will dash the government to scale back its ambitions for coal-fired plants. Will intimidate the government? No. Success cannot intimidate. Intimidate means to terrify, to frighten. Success cannot terrify the government. To persuade? Yes. Persuade means to encourage, to convince. Okay. So, the solar success will encourage the government to scale back its ambitions for coal-fired plants. Precede means something that comes before. Okay, so this is wrong. Allocate means to designate. Apprise means to inform. Okay, fine. So the right answer is option B. So here I'll end the session today. Tomorrow again I will be uploading a video for your SBI clerk mains examination. I'm very sorry that I'm not able to take live classes, but regularly I'll be uploading videos. So please watch the sessions and do write in the comment box if you have enjoyed the session. And also please subscribe to the channel and also click the bell icon. Bye.